Hi friends, starting with the 18th Jan editorial. So before that, sorry for the delay in posting the videos. As I was caught up with few things, I couldn't post the video on the same day. So again, sorry for the delay. Now I've made the editorials as comprehensive as possible and as simple as possible, so it'll be easier for you to revise. So now let's move on to the 18th Jan editorial. The first editorial is the, and I've combined two editorials. One is a wake up call and another is don't let messengers shoot themselves. Both the editorials speaks about the, you know, the recent issue where the, you know, BSF personnel, they started posting video expressing their grievances. First, you know, the video was posted by the BSF constable Tej Bahadur Yadav. After that, you know, what happened was a flurry of videos by various personnels, you know, army personnels expressing their grievance regarding both, basically about two things. One is regarding the food, another regarding the colonial era practice. So before going into that, let's look into the history of the BSF, also known as Border Security Force. So the Border Security Force Bill was introduced in 1968. So while introducing the bill, the Home Minister Yashwant Rao Chavan told the Rajya Sabha that Border Security Police, it is the function, you know, it is the function is not policing actually. It is more than policing. But even the, since it functions on the border, it's not army. So the task of this force, the task of Border Security Force, is something between the army and the police force. So the function is something more than police force, but it's not an army. So therefore, the Border Security Force falls somewhere in between the police force and the army. The concern expressed while introducing the bill was regarding the difference between the army and Border Security Force regarding the pay, service condition, grievance redress mechanisms and deployment to the forward areas. So they, even though they had the similar functions, the difference, there was huge difference between these four things. So now, given the present scenario, if you look at the present scenario, we feel that their concern is still there because there's a lot of difference between the army and Border Security Force, and it's also, and the same thing is also expressed in those videos. Now this is very important for PT point of view. There are 7 paramilitary forces in our country. So let's look into that. So they are namely Central Reserve Police Force, which is called CRPF, then Border Security Force, BSF, Indo-Tibetan Border Police, which is ITBP, then Central Industrial Security Force, which is CISF, and Sahastra Seema Bal, SSB, and Assam Rifles. And 7th one is Special Frontier Force, which is SFF. Now, for PT point of view, you know, these 5 forces, which is CRPF, BSF, ITBP, CISF and SSB, they are, these 5 forces together are combined and they're called as in CAPF. So the 5 forces are called as in CAPF. Now basically only Assam Rifles and Special Frontier Force are called as in paramilitary forces, but this others also include. So this first 5 are combinedly called as in CAPF, Central Armed Police Force. Another important thing to remember for PT point of view is this, all the paramilitary forces, they come under the Home Ministry, in contrast to the Army, Air Force, Navy and Coast Guard, which come under the Defense Ministry. So this paramilitary forces come under the Home Ministry, whereas Army, Air Force, Navy and Coast Guard, they come under the Defense Ministry. So this is very important for PT point of view. And let's look into Assam Rifles, which is a special case. You know, this being Assam Rifles has changed hand between the Home Ministry, External Affairs Ministry and Defense Ministry, but presently it is under Home Minister. So even the Assam Rifles is under Home Ministry, while the Defense Ministries, while it is under the Defense Ministry's Operation Control. So the Operation Control is under the Defense Ministry, but the Assam Rifles is under the Home Ministry. So the basically Assam Rifles is under Home Ministry, but only the operational control is under the Defense Ministry. So that's it. So this is very important for the PT point of view. Now let's look into the complaints and grievances expressed by the Jawans in those videos. One is regarding the poor quality of food. So they, you know, the video, there was a video showing about the very poor quality of food, like dried rotis, or the watery dal, etc. And now this one quote which can be used in the essay, that is, you know, then, but it was by Napoleon Bonaparte. He says an army marches on its own stomach, and this is also, you know, shown. This is also like what is shown in those videos. So army served like the poor quality food. Now other grievance was the sahayak or the buddy system. The sahayak or buddy system is nothing but, you know, where in this professional soldiers are forced to do personal work of the officers, like washing clothes, polishing boots, taking a doctor walk, etc. So these are the colonial era practices. Now you know, if an IFS officer is posted abroad, he is entitled to one domestic help. You know, he can take one domestic help with him if he is posted abroad, whereas there's no such provision for the, you know, for the officers in the paramilitary forces. Therefore, you know, jawans are forced to do this, do the work of the domestic help. Now there is a proposal to, you know, to bring out an non-combatant assistance or helpers, but you know, the concern is this might increase in the expenditure, which is already, you know, the government is already spending a lot on the army. So if you introduce another set of helpers for the, you know, officers, this might increase the expenditure. But you know, if you take the grievances of the soldiers, I feel it's better, you know, to better invest in the helpers other than degrading the morale of these forces. Then there's also a proposal to bring out the system to address the grievances. So there should be a system, you know, so that soldiers can, you know, express their grievances instead of bringing onto the social media. Now let's looking into the tribunal. There was this armed forces tribunal in 2000, which was brought out in 2007. But you know, this armed force tribunal, it leaves out the paramilitary forces and the coast guard. So this can be also used, this can also be asked in PT. So the armed forces tribunal, it leaves out paramilitary forces and coast guard. So basically there's nothing, you know, there's no system where the, you know, paramilitary forces can express their grievances and ensure the redressal for the same. And we also, you know, we all know that there is court martial system within the military, and judicial scrutiny is also available for that. But you know, for paramilitary forces, they follow their own court martial like system called the security force court. So paramilitary forces, they have their own court martial like system, which is called the security force court, with less legal safeguards. So they have the less legal safeguards compared to the court martials, those followed in the military. So even though they have these, you know, less legal safeguard, but you know, the penalties including death sentences can be imposed by the security force court. And other problems faced by the paramilitary forces is that there is no process of appeal other than statutory petitions. So the forces can appeal only through the statutory petitions, and that too only before the Home Minister. But you know, this process of appealing through statutory petitions is very expensive and time consuming. And also, given that, you know, the fundamental rights of the armed force personnel is limited under the Article 33, you know, this also makes approaching the civilian judicial system as a challenge. So these paramilitary forces are not completely free to approach the civilian judicial systems to express their or to for the redressal of their grievances. So revising this, first is that the paramilitary forces have their own court called security force court with less legal safeguards, but you know, they can impose the penalties like death sentences. And also, the, you know, only way of appeal is through statutory petition, that only to the Home Minister, and this statutory petition is a very expensive and time consuming process. And you know, they cannot also approach the civilian judicial system with complete freedom, because the fundamental rights of the armed forces personnel are limited under Article 33. And you know, government is also taking few measures to reduce the stress and boost the morale of our forces, like, you know, the better dispute resolution and better communication facilities and yoga, and also increased interaction between the jawans and the officers. So this were the various measures taken by the government. Now let's look into a mains question. So taking an example question, one question from this issue can be that, you know, given that fundamental rights for the, you know, for the armed personnel are restricted, or given that, you know, fundamental rights are restricted for the paramilitary forces, does posting a video lead to the violation of the rules? So before looking into that, let's look into the various fundamental rights, you know, which are limited for the armed forces. So, under Article 33, the Parliament restricts the fundamental rights to the police, armed force, paramilitary, and intelligence agency. And, you know, this also includes the workers under police, armed force, and paramilitary, including the barber, carpenter, etc. So, now let's look into the various fundamental rights which are not given to this armed personnels. So the armed personnel, they do not have the right to form the associations, and they do not also have the right to be a part of trade union, and they do not have the freedom of speech, and they also, you know, the other right curtailed is right to communicate with the press, and also right to attend the public meeting. So these are the fundamental rights which are curtailed to the armed personnel. So given this, like the freedom of speech, right to communicate with press, and the right to attend public meetings, does posting a video, you know, does it lead to the violation of rules? So I would request you to give me your opinion in the comment section. So basically, we know that the armed personnel have to, you know, they have to function under the limited fundamental rights. So, you know, given that, does it lead to a violation of the rules? Do you think posting a video or expressing the grievances through a social platform leads to the violation of the rules, which are set by the parliament? So please comment. Now let's move on. And one more thing regarding the restriction of the fundamental rights to the armed personnel is that, you know, the writ, the court martials are excluded from the writ jurisdiction of the court. So this also is important for PT. So therefore, the court martials are excluded from the writ jurisdictions of the courts. So now let's move on to the next editorial. Next editorial is in the nick of time. This editorial speaks about the, you know, the recent agreement between the states and center regarding the share of the taxes or the assesses in relation to the industries. So let's look into that. First, let's see what is GST Council. The GST Council include the Union Finance Minister, who is the chairman, and also Union Minister of State in charge of the revenue or finance, and also includes the Minister in charge of finance or taxation, which are appointed by the state government. This GST Council also abstracts the dispute resolution mechanism, and also, you know, decides about the various tax rates, etc. Now, according to the recent agreement, with the industries of turnover less than 1.5 crores, the 90% of the assesses will go to the state and the 10% go to the central. And with the in the industries with the turnover more than 1.5 crore, 50% goes to the central and 50% goes to the state governments. And this is a very good measure for the, you know, states to meet the revenue losses, especially due to the demonetization. Now, coming to the concerns of an important stakeholder, that is the industry. So industry, they have asked for more time in order to, you know, in order to comply to the rules, and they're also concerned regarding the harsh penal provisions. Like, you know, the more clarity, and there should be more clarity regarding the harsh penal provisions, like the power to arrest as proposed in the, you know, draft GST law, and the creation of anti-profiteering authority that can act against the firms if the firms fail to pass on the benefits of tax rate cuts to the consumers. So there are a few concerns. One is the power to arrest. Another is the anti-profiteering authority, which, you know, which can act against the industries if the industry do not pass on to the benefits of the, you know, benefits of the tax rate cut to the customers. So if the industries do not pass the tax rate cut benefits to the customers, then the anti-profiteering authority can act against it. So it's very much essential to protect the interest of the consumers, but also, you know, we also look into the fears of the other stakeholder, that is the industry. We have to, and also it's very much essential for the government to ensure that the Inspector Raj doesn't come into picture again. You know, therefore, to conclude, the government, which is committed to end the tax terrorism, it is very much essential for the government to address the concerns of all the stakeholders like industries, customers, and the state, center, etc. And also have to check various loopholes so that it does not lead into the violation or misuse of the powers. Now let's move on to the next editorial, which is the real meaning of the independence for RBI. This editorial basically speaks about the independence of the RBI and the, you know, there are few complaints about the, you know, government's intervention or interference in the working of the RBI. So this editorial basically looks into that. This is a very good article which can be asked in mains and PT both. Now, see, the demonetization decision has led, you know, several observers to express the concern that the autonomy and institutional integrity of the RBI. So they have expressed the concern that, you know, the autonomy and institutional integrity of the RBI is being compromised, and many who are against the demonetization are also blaming the RBI for caving into the government's diktat and surrendering independence. So many are blaming the RBI for surrendering, you know, for surrendering its independence to the government. So now let's look into various issues. Let's see whether really government has interfered into the independence of the RBI. So let's look into the various issues between the government and the RBI. So the government main work is regarding the policy decisions. So it has to bring out the policies and take various decisions according to that. So the various decisions taken by the government was, one is the demonetization, other is will be regarding the rate of inflation. And the RBI's work are the, you know, setting the interest rate, regulation of banks, acting as a debt manager, and also looking or seeing through the inflation and monetary policy. So the RBI's work, like interest rates and regulation of banks, you know, government has not much interfered in that. So this is just, you know, this is complete autonomy of the RBI regarding, RBI has a complete autonomy regarding setting the interest rate and regarding the regulation of the banks. But there are few controversial issues, that is regarding the, one is regarding the debt, RBI being the debt manager of the government, and regarding the, you know, setting the inflation targets, other being the monetary policy. Now, first let's look into a first issue, that is demonetization. So if you take the RBI Act, the Section 7 says that, you know, the Part 1 of Section 7 states that central government may from time to time give such directions to the bank as it may after consultation with the governor of the bank, which is considered necessary in the public interest. So basically the government can give directions to the RBI after consulting the RBI governor. Okay, after consulting the RBI governor, it can give directions to the RBI regarding, you know, which are considered necessary in the public interest. So therefore, the demonetization comes under this. So therefore, the demonetization also comes under this. It was like the demonetization of the high denomination currency was taken by the government in the public interest after the consultation with the governor. So this does not lead into interference in the working of the RBI. You know, see, RBI, like other central banks, it consists of technocrats and bureaucrats who are unelected, and they're not directly accountable to the people. So we haven't elected the RBI governor or people working in RBI, and they're not accountable to us, right? So the final responsibility of the policy decision. So demonetization is nothing but the policy decision. So the final responsibility of the policy decision must lie with the elected representatives of the people, that is with the government or with the parliament. So basically, who has to take the policy decisions? Either government or parliament. So demonetization, which is nothing but a policy decision, has been taken by the government, and therefore, and RBI work is only to follow the directions given by the government. So therefore, the demonetization does not lead into the interference in the working or autonomy of the RBI. Now let's move on to the next issue, which is the inflation. See, the government duty is to set the targeted rate of inflation. So the government has to set a target regarding the inflation. So once the target is set, or once the target is laid down, it is a duty of the central bank to meet those targets with the complete autonomy. Then after the target is set, the RBI is given a complete autonomy to meet those targets. So the setting of the target is a duty of the government. Therefore, if the government sets the target of the inflation, it definitely does not lead into an interference in the working of the RBI. Now, let's come to the other issue called monetary policy. So we all know that RBI is responsible in regarding the monetary policy. So before, what happened was that only RBI governor had complete control over the monetary policy goals. So only RBI governor used to set the monetary policy goals without consulting others. Okay. After that, what happened is that government brought out the monetary policy framework. Under this, there are group of experts who take the decisions regarding the monetary policy. This is somewhat justifiable because, given that RBI governor is an unelected official, so if we're giving all the independence to the RBI governor, this will be too much independence. To an unelected official. Therefore, it is very much essential, the monetary policy decisions to be taken by a group of experts with mutual consent. So therefore, again, we have shown that the monetary policy framework does not lead into an interference in the working of the RBI. Now, next is the RBI being the debt manager. We all know that RBI acts as a debt manager of the government. Now, there is a proposal by the government to bring out the independent debt management agency. But the RBI has resisted this move. Now, let's see if this independent debt management agency will lead into a compromising of the autonomy of the RBI. So the separation of debt management from the RBI is not an assault on the RBI's independence by the government. Instead, it is to remove the conflict of interest that exists in the RBI's function of setting the interest rate and management of government's debt. So see, the RBI, it also sets the interest rate. So RBI is setting the interest rate, and it is also acting as the management of the government's debt. So what is happening is that in these two functions, there is this conflict of interest. There are very good chances that while setting or while managing the government debt, so the pressure on managing the government debt may influence, to reduce or increase the interest rates. So given this conflict of interest regarding the two functions of the RBI, in order to bring out the RBI's independence, the government has brought out this debt management, independent debt management agency. So therefore, the RBI has complete independence, autonomy, and can completely focus on its very important functions like monetary policy, setting the interest rate, etc. So this does not compromise the independence or autonomy of the government. This ensures that RBI is freed from the conflict of interest. So these are the three editorials which I found important. There's other editorial which is called an Afghan agenda for Trump. This editorial basically speaks about the US and Afghan relationship. So this we have already discussed in other editorials, so I didn't find it much important. So that's it for today's editorial. If you found this editorial useful, please like and subscribe to my channel, and also give me your feedback. And please comment or tell me your answers about the questions I've asked.